I'm Sid Cronenthal, and I'm the director of the Department of Human Services for the city of Culver City. And I've been asked to come here and share some of the history and the background of the Western Hemisphere Marathon, one of the oldest marathons in the United States and contested in Culver City. And it's been there ever since.
When I was in high school, I was a LA City Schools champion in cross country and track in the mile, and I believe the cross country distance was 2 miles, and got a lot of scholarship offers, and decided that I wanted to go where a good coach was. The local junior college in Woodland Hills, Pierce Junior College, recruited me and a bunch of other distance runners from the San Fernando Valley in the early 60s, and we had quite a powerhouse there, and I learned a lot about distance running through these coaches. Bob Chambers and Athos Peterson, who I have to definitely give a lot of credit to for my early career in running. Not only as far as my speed and competition is concerned, but changing my form and paying a lot of attention to that, which when I was in high school, I was all over the place. By the time I got out of college, I pretty much knew what I was doing as far as my form was concerned, which is probably the most important thing in running fast. Collegiately, I was All-American about 7 times in track and cross country at Humboldt State University, and that was in the late 60s, early 70s. And I didn't really start running marathons until 1970, which the Western Hemisphere Marathon was my first marathon that year, and I placed second behind Byron Lowry. About the only marathon you could run on the West Coast at the time, and this was in the late 60s, early 70s, was the Western Hemisphere Marathon, which sometimes got crossed over and they called it the Culver City Marathon. And it comes at a good time of year for collegiate runners because it's between seasons. It's between cross country and track, and you're kind of like at a level of complete fitness from cross country, getting ready to go into indoor training. So you're probably at a good rest period, your body's resting, and it's a good time to run a slower, longer type pace. It was tough. I had to do a lot in that 1 year between 70 and 71. I had to do a lot of over distance stuff, weekend long runs, 20 mile runs and things like that to prepare for a marathon the following year, and I wanted to run much better. Seemed to work out anyway. Boy, I've been asked that question many, many times. How long will they last, or how long should they last? First of all, you should take a look and monitor your shoes as you're training, and if you find out that your heel strike and your toe off is, the wear on the shoe at the heel and the toe is starting to go into the white, in other words, the black outer sole is starting to wear off, it's time to get a new pair of shoes. I don't believe in resoling because it's a heat process and it hardens the midsole. So I think it's best to go and, you know, bite the bullet and buy another pair of $70 shoes. I don't think that you need to spend $100 or over $100 for a pair of shoes. I think $70, right around the $70 range, is perfect. And next thing is, don't look in a book or a magazine and try to figure out what shoe is going to be good for you. You want to go to the store, you want to try on a lot of shoes, you want to make sure that it's a known brand shoe, such as Adidas, a Nike, New Balance, Tiger, Asics Tiger, and there's a couple other companies out there, and try them on, see what feels good. You should be able to put them on and run down the street and come back and see if it feels good. If it doesn't feel good on your foot walking out of the store, you're not going to break it in. It's got to feel good on your foot while you're there and while you're trying it out. Well, the number one thing I would do is go to a reputable running dealership, such as the little private ones that are around that are owned and operated by a runner, preferably somebody that was a world-class runner at one time or knows a lot about running, maybe a coach who owns a running store. And you can see all kinds of theories on what you should be doing as far as diet's concerned. I think you ought to be eating a lot of carbohydrates, complex carbohydrates, definitely. Eating daily, your daily intake of food should be no more than or no less than what you're normally used to, because the body metabolizes what it's used to taking in. You'll probably find yourself, the better fit you are, resorting to eating a lot more because the body needs more fuel, but that comes in time. It's like a catch-22. Once you start training more, you want to start eating more, and vice versa. I think that talking about diet the day before the run or the morning of the run, a lot of carbohydrates, what your body can take, and to not do anything different than what you normally want to do anyway. You don't want to change boats in the middle of the stream just before a competition. You want to keep everything basically the same, so you keep your diet the same. You don't do anything, any extra things to do that. But high sources of carbohydrates is good. I mean, things such as pasta, potatoes, pizza. Italian foods are high in it. Try to stay away from the spicy ends of it. Try to stay away from the high sources of protein type things, and mainly just what I like to call English food, you know, potatoes and pastas and things like that. Water is very essential. I think all your major athletes now know the positive ends of drinking lots and lots of water to supply all of the cells of the body, not only the skin cells individually, but the organ cells themselves, the hearts. The whole body is made up of cells, and needless to say, everybody knows the body is like 95% water, so it's going to have to get that water from someplace, especially when you're perspiring so much in a long-distance run. The supplements that are out there are really good, too, such as Exceed and ERG. There's a lot of them out there now. Cytomax, the good type fluids that replenish moisture or your water air, sweat that comes out in your sweat, basically, as you're running. To replenish that right away. I think those are good supplements to use while you're in the race itself. Even a marathon is considered long, especially those people who are out there running 4 or 5 hours. You can have physical breakdowns. Your hollow organs can deteriorate. Your kidneys can go bad on you. You can get a breakdown there. That's probably one of the first things that happen to you is your kidneys go. You can get hyperthermia or hypothermia, depending upon the weather and how much fluids you're taking in. You can become hypoglycemic, which means you're basically burned up all the proteins you possibly can and all the sugars you possibly can. And what happens is your body then starts burning its own muscle, you're actually burning muscle tissue at the same time and eating into your protein, your own protein. So you break down quickly that way. There's a lot of other things that can go wrong. Blisters, needless to say, happens, especially inexperienced runners. Chafing, bad chafing can happen. You can get shin splints. I mean, there's tons of things. Stitches, you know, from your diet being incorrect. A lot of gaseous foods can cause that, and that can tear you up too. You can quit easily if you get a really bad stitch. It's kind of like a gas pain under the diaphragm, right up under your lungs, and it's a side ache. But it becomes real bad when you're running because most people don't know how to rid themselves of that kind of a pain, so they try to run through it and it just gets worse. You basically have to stop, bend over at that side, and press in with your fingers and breathe in deep, take some deep breaths, and eventually it'll loosen itself up and dissipate throughout the system. But that's about all you can do. I mean, there's nothing else you can do, and if that doesn't relieve it, maybe there's some other problem, overriding problem that you need to see a doctor about. They need a coach to teach them how not to. Being a coach now, and I've been coaching for quite some time, over 18 years, I like to, if a guy is coming to me and he's going to say, or a woman comes to me and say that they're going to run a marathon, I'd like to get them training for a 10K. I think that the 10K type training, interval work twice a week, which is speed work, and running long, slow distance the rest of the times to build up the aerobic endurance end of it will do far more for their speed and running a good marathon, as will specific training for long distance marathon running, nothing but long, slow distance, which we call LSD training. I prescribe 2 times a week, usually Monday and Wednesday, or Tuesday and Thursday, of interval training, speed work on the track, under a watch, under a coach. And the other days, the alternate days, doing long, slow distance, probably about an hour's worth of running. And then on the weekend, one long run consisting of about two and a half hours worth of running, anywhere from 15 to 20 miles of running. This, I think, can prepare them not only for a fast time in 10K, but in case they want to jump up and run a marathon, it'll permit them to run a real decent time. I do not think that running 4 marathons in 4 months, which I have done before, is a good idea. I think a couple a year is fine, and you don't need to run any more than that. The marathon is kind of like the ultimate run of a distance runner, and I don't think you need to run too many of them. I mean, once is good enough. Right now, I'm kind of a cross trainer and do a lot of distance running, around about 10 miles a day to keep fit, and probably a 2-hour run on the weekend, either Saturday or Sunday, which is between 15 and 20 miles, depending upon how I'm feeling. And I do a lot of weight training now. I ride a Nordic track 3-4 times a week. I bicycle a couple of times a week. So I stay pretty fit doing lots of other things besides running. And I like it. I like to be able to branch out. It got kind of boring there for years and years and years. I ran for 20 years straight trying to stay world class, and it got kind of boring. So I kind of like the idea now being able to branch out. And I just got my diver certificate, so I'm a PADI certified diver, so I can dive anywhere around the world. So it's fun. Well, I've run a couple of 50 milers. It's been a couple, 3 years ago. I ran a 50 miler in 1988 to prepare myself for the Western States 100 miler, which is that 24-hour run up in Northern California. And I ran right at 6 hours, and I was real happy with that. That was, I believe, back in 1988. I plan on running again another 50 in April of 93 to prepare myself again for the Western States 100 miler. It's a 100-mile race that starts in Squaw Valley, Tahoe, and finishes in Auburn, and you have to do it in 24 hours, so it's kind of a challenge there. Why anybody wants to do it, who knows? It's a belt buckle, and I mean, why does anybody climb a mountain? I guess it's the same mentality. Kind of a little bit of craziness, too, old age and treachery. Maybe that's it, too. But as far as my future in running is concerned, I just want to continue to stay fit and train every day and feel good about it. It's my religion, so.
The very first activity is the start of the Western Hemisphere Marathon. These men will run 26 miles and 385 yards, classic marathon distance. Out of the stadium they go, through the streets of Los Angeles, to finish back in the stadium about 2.5 hours later. There's many a mile still to travel before returning to the finish tape. And now the marathoners return, and the winner is the Canadian champion, Gerald Côté. Côté is a happy victor. His time is 2 hours, 42.5 minutes. Joe Smith of Massachusetts is second and congratulates the winner. And Paul H. Helms, donor of the trophies for the Western Hemisphere Marathon, makes the presentation to Smith, Côté, and Dave Mazzio, the third place winner.
Tom Ryan was a premier runner. He won our marathon in record time. He competed for the Culver City Athletic Club. He was probably the best runner in the Middle West. Came out here to train in California about 35 years ago. He was a premier runner all over the United States.
See, that was first time they ran in the winter, 1959, and it was first Sunday in December. See, and there was Bobby Kahns, Alex Henderson, Hal Higdon, Dave Pastema. They had some pretty top guys who were running. And Alex Henderson was Australia's number one, probably one of the top 3 5,000-meter guys in the world, and the current U.S. 5,000-meter champ in track. So he was a world-renowned runner, and he was going to try and make the qualify for the Australian Olympic team in the marathon, and he was really good and well-known. And he was in, and Bobby and I were very disillusioned, really, because we kind of thought one of us would win. So anyway, before 15 miles, he was tiring. We could see it. So I told Bobby, I said, we can catch this guy. And Bobby wasn't feeling good. He felt terrible. And so I took after him. And sure enough, at about 18 miles, I passed him. And at 20 miles, I passed Hal Higdon. And it's strange, I never felt so good in all my life. I just felt fabulous all the way. Feet didn't hurt. I felt super in the last 5 miles. And I broke the record. I did a 2:28. That was my one and only win in the marathon. You wouldn't believe the clodhoppers we ran in. I remember I used to get big thick tennis shoes, and I couldn't get them in white, so I got them in black, and I'd soak them in a bucket of bleach, and they'd turn white. I remember I went to Boston, ran Boston, I cut them down. ran Boston because they're nice and white. And 2 days later, I went to work out, and I grabbed the shoes to put them on, and they came apart. And I was thinking that could have happened in the Boston race. But we had, you know, soles you can hear us coming about 12 miles away, clop, clop, clop. And God, like, they were terrible. And then, you know, your feet would just bleed, and you'd have your feet all torn to shreds, and then they'd finally fit, and then the shoes would disintegrate on you. There was no effort whatsoever put in the shoes. There was one company, Hyde Shoe in Massachusetts, that made running shoes for runners, and that was it. Then they're now called Spot Belt. But not until 1961, the Japanese started coming out with some shoes made for distance runners. You know, they do this carbo loading now, which is a scientific thing to do, but I craved, before big races, I would crave spaghetti. Before I won in 1959, I must have had 4 pounds of spaghetti. I just craved it. I couldn't get enough of it. And then in the morning, I craved oatmeal. It was, you know, the best thing I could have done. But there was no talk about carbo loading or the shoes. There was no talk on shoes. They had no shoes you could buy. No carbo loading, and you were not to drink when you ran. So a lot of things have changed. People are doing so much better now, but they're learning from our boo-boos. You know, we made the mistakes, and you know, the shoes, the drinking. I ran a marathon just before I lost my leg at Palos Verdes, and I didn't know what these drinks were. I thought somebody was washing their socks, and we had, I think it was Erg, which didn't taste too good to me. I didn't know what it was. It tastes like rancid water. I wasn't expecting it. I thought somebody was tampering with the water. But I really did feel better, and it did give me a shot. I really believe in them. And then I decided the only thing I think I could do was maybe run and try for the marathon. So I trained for and ran in 1952. The Boston Marathon, in which I did 4 hours and 6 minutes, and I thought I was going to die. It was 86 degrees, and I was training in 20 degrees in Iowa. I thought, I can't go home, because the city sent me. I had a big hullabaloo, big write-up in the paper, and I ran 4:06, and the sun was down, the newspapers were blowing down the street, and I got on the plane, and I was never going to run again, ever. Sat next to a little guy with glasses. He was reading a bunch of papers that had to do with the marathon, and I asked him if I could read them. So he introduced himself. He got fifth in Boston, and I told him how discouraged I was. It turns out the guy was a shrink. He was a psychiatrist, among other things. So I got out of college. Anyway, he pumped me back up psychologically, spiritually, mentally, gave me a training program. Got back off the plane. I never would have run again. I never. That did it. But anyway, I did exactly what he told me for one solid year. I went back next year, and I didn't do that much better in place-wise, but I chopped off almost 2 hours. I did a 2:49. If it wasn't for that psychiatrist, I never would have run again. His name was Charlie Robbins.
Bobby was one of the premier runners in the world. Probably won more national championships from a mile to the marathon than any person in the history of Southern California. He was a young Mexican-American athlete, and by sheer perseverance, by sheer dedication, became one of the great runners of all time.
Met Bobby my first day here, and Bobby won in 1953. Bobby won, I think, 5, 6, 7 times. And people don't realize, but he was in the first five, God knows how many times after that. He's probably the minimum of first five more than anybody that's ever run. Bob was very short, didn't look like a jock. I knew he'd been to Korea and was shot up, but his calves were shot away. They weren't there. There was just like slices on them. And he had these little hairy legs. And he didn't have much class as a runner. I mean, as far as he just ran. And there was one race, the last race we ran in the summer here in Culver City. It was 98 degrees, and it was like the weather now. It's just horrible. And we got about 18 miles, and we're coming down Higuera Street And I felt pretty good, so I just left him. And then they were digging a ditch. They were digging a sewer. And he could see it about a mile away, and he said, "God, whatever, don't let me fall in that sewer," because he was out of his mind. And he said he just went and kaplop right in. In the year I won it, Alex Henderson was supposed to break the world record. But at 14 miles, we knew that we were going to catch him. And I said, "Bob, let's get going. We're going to catch this guy. We're going to win this thing." And he said, "You go ahead. I don't feel so hot." So I said, "Here's my lucky bowling ball. Carry this, and this will help you." Yeah, I remember one race. He ran Boston, and he screwed up. It was one of those hot days. And he said that he just was dying, so he ran into a gas station, and his feet were just on fire. And it was about 85 degrees, and so he pulled off his shoes and he jammed them into the guy said, "Put them in the grease tank." And this was this black green grease. But he said, "Oh God, it felt so good." He plunged his feet in. He said, but then he put his shoes back on. He said he went to go down the street. He said his feet were sliding around. He'd going to make he'd going to turn, and his feet would keep going. He said it's like running on Jell-O.
At the first 1948 Western Hemisphere Marathon, one of my former teammates from USC, who was coaching at Jefferson High School, a man by the name of Estel Johnson, who was a great 400-meter hurdler, he came up to me and he says, "I have a boy in the high school mile. He's 19 years of age, and he can run all day long. And I'd like to have you help and train him." And from then on, I took Bobby on for 11 years. I coached him as a hobby, and he represented the Culver City AC. And I coached him and some of the other boys from Culver City.
Well, women were excluded from certain running events, and particularly the marathon. They thought it was not the best interest of women, childbearers, so to speak, and they had some real antiquated, really unfounded reasons for excluding women. We were very proud of the Western Hemisphere Marathon because we were the first marathon to get official sanction to allow women to compete. Two of the great ones who set world records on certified courses was Jackie Hansen, the great Jackie Hansen, who was the biggest proponent of women reforms, and Mickey Gorman, a young Japanese-American who just startled the world by running faster than most of the men.
When I started running, it was already women were allowed to enter, but a couple years after. But I still remember many people were critical that women to run on the street and compete against the men. And quite often, even a runner used to give me a dirty look and saying, "What are you doing here? Or what are you trying to prove? Or you should be in the kitchen," you know, word like that. But it didn't bother me so much. I started running when I was 33 years old. It's quite a long time ago. That was December 1973. That marathon was my first completed official marathon. It was very memorable. Our award ceremony, yes, I was looking forward to receive one of the trophy. Lineup of probably how many dozens of trophy was on the table. And I thought, "Oh, one of those is mine." I was so looking forward to receive one. And one by one, giving to the boys and the men. And after all, there was no trophy left. And I was very disappointed.
I remember women being in the races and the officials having a hard time with that. I think the runners never really cared that much. They thought it was a good deal. In fact, a lot of the runners that I knew liked the idea that women were running in our races. It was a neat thing to do. I mean, it's, you know, it's, give women a chance, for Pete's sake. It's not the Dark Ages anymore, and I mean, it was way over the time that should have taken to have a woman in the race. But I can remember pictures in the newspaper, especially in Boston, I think a couple of years before that, where I actually showed one of the old officials grabbing a woman and trying to yank her out of the race. And women couldn't officially enter any of these longer distances because the old echelon, the old officials thought that it was damaging to them to do that, when actually it's the other way around. It's probably more damaging to a man to run a marathon than it is for a woman. Well, I appreciate you inviting me here to discuss a Western Hemisphere Marathon and promote the race. Like I said, it's my favorite race, and I've enjoyed it. And 45 years of running this particular race, I got to hand it to Sid Cronenthal for putting it together to begin with, and putting on such a wonderful continuous race for the last 45 years. And I thank you.